On today's program, Extension Water Resources Specialist Sal Atagvian tells us how to conserve water with soil moisture sensors. Kim has some beautiful and tough alternatives to Japanese maples. We stop winter weeds before they get started. Barbara Brown cooks a beef, bean, and barley soup. Kim has a trick to get more life out of our Fritillaria bulbs. And former host Ray Campbell has our gardening tips for November. Gardening is a production of the Oklahoma Cooperative Extension Service as part of the land grant mission of the Division of Agricultural Sciences and Natural Resources at Oklahoma State University, dedicated to improving the quality of life of the citizens of Oklahoma through research-based information. Underwriting assistance is provided by TLC, Oklahoma's leading garden center, Southwood Landscape and Nursery, Tulsa's source for great gardens, and the Oklahoma Department of Agriculture, Food, and Forestry, helping to keep Oklahoma green and growing.
We're at the Cimarron Valley Research Station in Perkins. Joining me is Dr. Sal Atagvian, Extension Specialist in Irrigation. And we're going to look at a tool that you're using in your grape studies to measure soil moisture. And what we're really looking at is water conservation.
That's correct. Water is a very valuable resource, especially in parts of the world like Oklahoma. And we want to be as efficient as possible with water applications.
And so we're applying this tool in a research setting, but it's something that can be used in many different areas.
That's correct. And some of these technologies, smart technologies like use of soil moisture sensors, they have really developed so far that are now available at very affordable prices. And you can use them effectively to not only be efficient with water application, but save on your water bill and energy bill as well.
All right, well, show us the product and tell me about it, how it works.
Sure. Well, the soil moisture sensor that we have installed at this research site is called a watermark sensor. And it's basically a granular matrix with two electrodes embedded in it. This matrix comes into equilibrium with the soil. As the soil gets higher in moisture, it reads a smaller resistance, and we can then convert that to the soil moisture level.
Okay, and in this research, you have these planted into the soil at the base of each plant. How deep do they get inserted?
Here in this field, we have installed the sensors at about 12 inches, right in the root zone of the grapes. And the reason is we want to be able to monitor all the water extraction by the roots.
Mm-hmm. So we'd want to keep that in mind depending on the type of plant it's being
That's
used
correct.
With. And so this is constantly reading soil moisture, which is a little bit different than soil probes that are taking a one-time measurement. And then you're actually logging all that data.
That's true, yeah. That's one of the main advantages of these type of sensors. You can connect them to a data logger, such as the one that we have here. And they stay in the soil for very long times. They have very low power requirement, and you can come to the field with a push of a button. You can see a graph of soil moisture. So for example, you can see after irrigation or rain events, the soil moisture level increased, and it shows that the profile was almost full. After irrigation, it starts decreasing as the grapes extracted that water and water evaporated from the soil surface. So you can use different limits to irrigate, and those limits will tell you if it's too soon to water, or if it's too late, or if it's just the right time.
And so you'll set that lower limit, and when the soil moisture gets to that, whatever the critical value is, it's going to tell the irrigation system to turn on.
Exactly, and it could be automatic to turn on a valve, or the operator could just check the graphs and decide if it's time to turn it on or not.
With grapes in particular, soil moisture is very critical, especially as the grapes go into maturity, right?
That's correct. Depending on what the grapes are going to be used for, we want to reach a specific level of sugars or taste or color in the grapes, and that requires a certain level of water stress. Technologies like soil moisture sensors can help us to make sure that we reach that a specific level of soil moisture and we maintain the high quality of grape.
Well, I love to see new technologies that help us be better stewards of the environment. Thank you so much for sharing.
My pleasure.
Hi there. I'm Ray Campbell. I'm an ambassador at the Botanic Garden at Oklahoma State, and here are your tips for the garden for November. In your lawn and turf area, now's the time to fertilize cool season grasses such as fescue using 1 pound of nitrogen per 1,000 square feet. Also, continue to mow fescue as needed at 2 inches and water during dry conditions. Also, now's the time to begin controlling broad-leafed winter weeds such as dandelions. Check our fact sheet, HLA6601. And finally, keep falling leaves off fescue, especially newly seeded fescue, to avoid damage and smothering to the foliage.
Japanese maples are a big draw for gardeners with their delicate foliage and graceful appearance, but the hot, dry summers of Oklahoma often leave those trees looking rather ragged. And today we'll look at some wonderful trees that can be planted as an alternative to Japanese maples for specimens in the landscape. The first is behind me. This is a Carolina buckthorn. Despite its common name, it doesn't have any thorns, and it's quite common well beyond the Carolinas, as far north to New York and south to Mexico. And one of the beautiful draws of this tree are those great berries. They turn from a bright red in the summertime to near black in the fall. These fruits are actually edible, but I prefer leaving them for the wildlife. They draw birds and other watchable animals into the landscape. The foliage on these trees are just a strong constant, that dark glossy green, and they hold their color well into the fall before turning color. And they produce a beautiful rounded crown. You can prune that up to get a little bit closer look at the smooth bark. Carolina buckthorn is a great alternative to Japanese maples in a sunny or partly shady location. Another tree for year-long interest is the fringe tree, whether it's the native or Chinese species. They both have showy white flowers in the spring and yellow autumn color and produce dark blue fruits. The multi-stem trunk and open canopy provide a strong specimen for the landscape. Fall fruits attract birds but do not produce a maintenance problem. Fringe trees tolerant of air pollution, making it an excellent selection for the urban landscape. Plant fringe tree in full sun to part shade conditions. The sumacs or rhus species are underutilized native plants in the landscape. They offer amazing structure and beautiful foliage. This is the staghorn sumac. We have several native species and starting to see improved cultivars such as the tiger eyes sumac, which offers beautiful golden foliage throughout the summer. Now all the sumacs catch fire in the fall with red foliage. You could see them along the roadsides, absolutely striking native plants, small growing trees or very large shrubs, and you could prune up the branches underneath for some very interesting character. Many gardeners are drawn to Japanese maples because of their colorful foliage. A hardy alternative is the smoke tree or Cotinus. Cotinus obovatus, that's the native species, it has chartreuse green foliage. We also have purple species that emerge with a plum colored foliage that matures to a dark green with red hints over the summer and will take on fall color, shifting to orange or purple. the best feature is the amazing summer explosion of flowers. They produce hundreds of small, airy flowers that stand up on top of the stems like a cloud of smoke, giving the plant its common name, smoke tree. Another native understory tree is the serviceberry or amelanchier. Another common name is juneberry, and that describes the fruiting habit of the tree. It produces edible, delicious small berries in June. Wildlife, of course, also love the berries as much as we do. The plant blooms very early in the spring with very showy white flowers. They're not incredibly long-lived, but do put on quite a show, followed by those blue-black berries. And we could see the autumn color starting to show. We'll get a golden and orange color covering the tree. Another beautiful feature is this smooth gray bark, and with some careful pruning, we could really show off that characteristic of the plant to provide some year-round interest. This is a wonderful tree to use either as a specimen or in your wildscape garden. This last specimen puts on an amazing show in the summertime. This is desert willow, Chilopsis linearis, and like the willows, it has very narrow leaves. It is covered in the summer with beautiful flowers that look a lot like orchids, and they'll come in waves from late spring throughout the summer months, really providing a knockout specimen. You want to put that in a location where you can see it on a daily basis. This is a great specimen for hot and dry locations, and you want to put it in a full sun spot where you have good drainage. It does not like to have water standing under its roots. The structure of the plant is very open, and eventually the trees can reach up to about 20 feet, but they're still very airy and open, which makes it very easy to plant beneath the desert willow. And that's a great characteristic when you're looking at a full sun location in the garden. So consider desert willow as a wonderful specimen for the landscape. And fall is the best time of year to plant these understory trees and all woody trees and shrubs in the landscape. So consider adding a specimen tree or understory tree to your landscape this fall.
Your tree and shrub tips in the garden for November are the following. You can now prune bleeder trees like maples, elms, and birch in the early part of winter. Prune only for structural and safety purposes. Wrap young, thin-barked trees with a commercial protective material to prevent winter scald. Now's the time to also apply dormant oil for scale-infested trees and shrubs, doing this before the temperatures fall below 40 degrees Fahrenheit. Be sure to follow label directions, as with all pesticides. And finally, for trees and shrubs, you can continue to plant bald and burlap trees. Water thoroughly after planting. Here are some tips for the flowers in your landscape. Tulips and other spring flowering bulbs can still be planted successfully through mid-November. Be sure to leave foliage on asparagus, mums, and other perennials, as this will help insulate crowns from harsh winter conditions.
As autumn sets in and the garden starts to go to sleep, we often forget about weed control, but this is the time of year that our cool season weeds, such as henbit, are actually germinating. And so we want to use this opportunity to treat with a pre-emergent, both in our turf areas and in our ornamental beds. There are many different pre-emergent herbicides available, some for turf and some for ornamental beds. Visit your county extension educator to learn what's the correct herbicide for your situation. Now, there's some places in the garden where we want to be careful about using a pre-emergent herbicide. This is a hellebore. This is Helleborus photitis, the stinking hellebore, and it's short-lived in the garden, but readily seeds itself. So I rely upon those new seedlings to keep this plant reproducing in the garden. So when we have plants like this that we want to seed, don't put a pre-emergent herbicide beneath it, or else we won't have adequate germination, and eventually the plants will die out in the garden. Today we're doing ground beef, bean, and barley soup. And as the weather chills down or as the weather warms up, depending on which season you're in, having soup that you can have through the week is actually a really great thing. So even if you're only one person, this one's definitely worth making the whole recipe of. I've got a half a pound of ground beef, and that's one of the nice things about this. As we see the cost of beef and pork and other meats going high, it's a nice way to reduce the amount and still get that flavor and texture that we all love with beef. What I've added to that, I've browned it just a little bit, and I've added a half a cup of onion. I'm also going to add a half a cup of chopped celery. And we're going to let those cook for just a little bit, let that onion become more translucent. Then we'll add a clove of garlic to it for just a quick time, and then we'll add pretty much everything else. While we're waiting for that to go ahead and soften, though, let's look for a minute at the barley. We are talking about a grain product. The kind of barley you choose to use is going to make a big difference on what you do with, as far as preparing the soup. The one I've got is a quick barley, which means it's pearled, which means it's not a whole grain. It's still really high in fiber, so it's still an excellent choice, but it's not the whole grain product that we're being encouraged to eat more of. If you choose, this one cooks in about 10 minutes. There's also pearled barley, which is gonna take a little bit longer to cook, still not a whole grain. Or you can go with whole barley, which is gonna take somewhere between 50 to 60 minutes. It's also harder to find, so unless you've got a source of it that's fairly handy or you have some way to get a hold of it and you also have a lot of time so that you can do that prep. Now, things like this are often things that we do on the weekend, so the time issue is often not so much, but finding it may be an issue in some of our small communities. I'm going to go ahead and add, I've got one clove of garlic that's been minced really well. And to that, I'm going to add a cup of crushed tomatoes. We're just going to put everything in here, and it's going to cook. We're going to let it cook for about 10 to 15 minutes. Also have a half a cup of carrots that I've cut in moons. You could just slice it if you chose to. And also, I'm going to add 2 cups of dried red beans. Now this is to take the place or the protein place of some of that meat that we're reducing in this recipe. Also have a half a teaspoon of dried basil, a bay leaf, and then I'm using 3/4 of a cup of the barley. Now this is something that's going to absorb a lot of water, so that's what we're using. I've got 7 cups of water that's going in here. Now because that barley is going to swell and absorb the water as this cooks, we're going to bring it to a simmer and put a lid on it and let it simmer for about 10 to 15 minutes, as I said, and then we're going to go ahead and add some more vegetables to this. So it's going to be a very nutritious recipe when we're done. I did start with a very lean beef. If you have started with a beef that's got a higher fat content, you may want to drain the fat off before you go ahead and add some of these other ingredients to it. You could also substitute other ground meats for it, or you could substitute other leftovers as well. Yeah, you could use something like a leftover pot roast, but you'd want to cut it up and then skip that browning stage and add it when the rest of the ingredients are added. Again, we're going to let this come to a boil, reduce it to a simmer, 10 to 15 minutes. You can see our soup is cooking up great down in here, and if I could pull up some barley, I would do so. You can see that it's substantially larger than it was before. What we're ready to do now is add more vegetables to it. So I've got 1 pound of frozen mixed vegetables, and one of the things I like about this soup is that it uses so many forms of food preservation. It has the canned beans, because I use canned kidney beans. It has fresh produce, it has frozen produce, and it has dried herbs. So if there's a way to preserve food other than freeze-dried, it's involved in this particular soup. I'm going to bring this back up to a boil and then turn it back down to a simmer and let it cook until those vegetables are done. And you can look at the label and find out about how long that's going to be. It's probably going to be somewhere between 10 to 15 minutes. Your mixed vegetables have lima beans in them, they're going to be on the longer end of the cook.
Okay, our soup has cooked down. It's thickened up somewhat. You can see the barley is even bigger than it was when we checked it the last time before we put those other vegetables in. We are now ready to serve it up. The only thing that we need to remember to do as service is proceeding is to take that bay leaf out. Nobody should have to do that at the table themselves, and they can be harmful if you actually swallow one. So I hope you'll try this one. It's a great meal. Tastes even better the second day, and if you're a one or two person family, you can store it in the freezer and have it further on down the line than that. I hope you'll try it. Ground beef, bean, and barley soup for Oklahoma Gardening. I'm Barbara Brown.
Fritillaria is an underused bulb that produces a beautiful orange flower, very unique. But one of the problems that gardeners have is the bulbs rot in the soil, so they don't last very long. People get frustrated with them. So we're going to look at a little trick to make them last longer. If you look at the bulbs from the top, they look kind of like a cinnamon roll, and they have openings inside here where water could get in and stand, and that's what contributes to the rotting. So we're going to use just sand, plain sand, and pack that in to the bulbs into those openings. And I'll do that for both of my bulbs. And this will just prevent water from standing inside of there. The other thing we're going to do that's rather unusual is plant our bulbs sideways. So rather than setting this up where any water that seeps through the sand will get in there, we're going to do it this way so that the water can drain out. And then they go in just like any other bulb. Because these bulbs need to be planted about 8 inches deep, I'm going to use a shovel to excavate a small hole. And remember to account for mulch when you're calculating the depth of your planting hole. I have a bit of a rocky soil here, but that's good. We want a very well-drained soil for our fritillaria so that we have good drainage. And remember to put the fritillaria on end so that that opening is sideways. And you can even grab a handful of sand and pack that in along the side just to fill any openings. And go ahead and cover it back up with soil. So you want to find a sunny spot for these plants. They are sun-loving. They'll reach a height of about 32 inches. And again, they need a very well-drained soil and proper care to ensure that they endure in the garden. And again, fritillaria need a nice sunny spot. They'll reach a height of about 32 inches, and they need a very well-drained soil so that they can endure in the garden.
In the fruit and nut orchard, delay pruning fruit trees until next February or March, just before bud break. You may also harvest pecans and walnuts, or should harvest pecans and walnuts immediately after falling to eliminate deterioration of the kernels. And finally, some miscellaneous tips in the garden for fall, and particularly in November, that you may want to be doing. Gather and shred leaves, add to compost, use as a mulch, or grind and till into garden plots. Clean and store garden landscape tools. Coat with a light application of oil to prevent rusting. Be sure to drain fuel tanks in your small equipment, irrigation lines, and hoses, and be sure to disconnect hoses from outside faucets before freezes. Bring hoses indoors to prevent winter freezing. Fall is a beautiful time in Oklahoma, and especially in the gardens. Now that leaves are beginning to turn, be sure to get out and enjoy our beautiful fall foliage color. Drive through the mountains or drive through the prairies or just visit a botanic garden in your area. I'm sure you will get a great deal of enjoyment out of seeing the foliage in Oklahoma this fall. I'm Ray Campbell, ambassador at the Botanic Garden at OSU.
Next week, Extension Assistant Becky Carroll goes samurai to harvest pecans and get them ready to store or process. Kim has a great shrub for wildlife and fall beauty. Extension entomologist Jackie Lee looks at some of the pests in our pecans. There's radicchio to check in the vegetable garden, and Kim gets us started with sprouts in the kitchen. Join us then for more TV You'll Grow to Love. For additional information, show notes, plant lists, recipes, and fact sheets, visit our website or contact your local Oklahoma Cooperative Extension Service office. Segments from this episode, along with hundreds more from previous episodes, are available on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/Oklahoma Gardening. Be sure to join our Facebook group for information on upcoming episodes and gardening events, photos, and discussions of gardening topics. Oklahoma Gardening is produced by the Oklahoma Cooperative Extension Service as part of the Division of Agricultural Sciences and Natural Resources at Oklahoma State University. The Botanic Garden at OSU is home to our studio gardens. This outdoor television studio is made possible with the help of our generous underwriters, TLC Garden Centers, Southwood Landscape and Nursery, and the Oklahoma Department of Agriculture, Food, and Forestry. Additional support is provided by Pond Pro Shops, Greenleaf Nursery, and the Garden Debut Plants, and the Oklahoma Horticultural Society.